Welcome everyone to day two of the South by Southwest live stream for the UK's Department for International Trade. I'm your host, Jimmy Conrad, and we're here at Great Britain House in Austin, Texas, to talk with and about British companies that are really driving innovation in the tech space. And in today's topic, our focus is going to be VR, virtual reality. Is it awesome? Is it just awesome? Is it super awesome? Is it really awesome? I mean, there's a lot for you guys to choose from. So I invited some of my friends here to get into this subject. I got Deepa, Mann-Kler, and
Jimmy.
Luke McNeice. Guys, thank you so much for joining me. They're from RETNE. Now, fun fact for you, that's enter spelled backwards. So that's, you'll remember that from here on out, RETNE. And then I got Tim Harper from the TIN. Tim, thank you so much for coming here today.
No problem, sir.
Okay, I'm going to start with you.
Yeah.
You might win Best Dressed Award. Just going to start there.
Always, man.
Second.
Representing.
I respect that. Tell me a little bit about the TIN's foray into VR.
Okay, so the TIN is a brand and technology agency. So we work with big brands. We also work with music artists. So we run monthly TIN innovation sessions, which is effectively R&D, research and development. And we set about starting new projects just to explore what we can do. We asked ourselves a question: what could you do in the virtual reality space that would be easier than doing on a traditional flat screen? And we started getting into this thing about exploring big data. And being music fans, the first point of call was music. So we basically tapped into the Spotify API, brought in 20 million artists, and built a virtual reality experience that allows you to explore those artists in a virtual reality environment, which is interesting, because rather than going from that very traditional view of like clicking an artist and seeing some recommended artists in a very list form, it allows you to literally journey through music. Because we've tapped into the Spotify API, effectively you can add a playlist, and as you click through artists, you build a playlist, so when you step out of the virtual reality experience, you go back to your computer, back to your car, you can listen back to all those artists. And we're looking to, obviously the music thing is fantastic, but this applies to all sorts of business, you know? Any sort of big data exploration is what we're really interested in, so.
Yeah. And that's fascinating. For you guys, tell us a little bit about RETNE. I don't know who wants to take the mic first.
Go ahead.
I'm a visual artist by background, and I most recently have been working in neon and large-scale public art festivals. I was in Lumiere in London. But last November, I was in Reykjavik on a holiday, and Bjork had her immersive experience for her last album by Ophelia in the Harper there. So we booked tickets and we went to see it, and it blew me away. That was my first experience with HTC Vive, and I had felt really sick that day, and I was actually thinking of staying at home. But the minute I put this headset on and engaged with that piece of music, Bjork was there, I was dancing with her. I felt physically completely transformed. I came back and I thought, I want to work in this. So I started phoning up companies in Belfast, and there was one name that kept coming up, and that was Kainos. And that led to a coffee with Luke in November.
So you're brain dumping on Luke. Luke, I've got all these ideas. This is what I want to do. This is what I want to explore. Help me realize that dream. And then Luke, you're like,
what happened to you? So we met for coffee, and you had a scrapbook, and it was full of ideas. And one of the challenges, I think, in VR is that a lot of people have had some bad experiences, and a lot of people, very few people, have had access to the really good equipment that kind of gives that. So you have this kind of really wide range in people's intent and what they think is possible. But what I seen from Deepa is she had some really interesting ideas about what I knew that would feel good in VR, and feel is like the operative word there. It's not about seeing or hearing, it's about how you feel. And it's really, like, I have these conversations all the time, you know, in the business world, and people just smile and nod, and you have to kind of just show it to them, because we don't have the language to describe what it feels like. Deepa talked about some experiences, and we wanted to take an experience out the South by Southwest. And, I mean, a little bit about how I got to this point was I work at a company called Kainos, and we have a couple of different businesses, financial sector, digital transformation, healthcare, and we also work for Workday. But I don't work in any of those, and actually I work in a place that helps the rest of the business bring new tech closer, kind of true innovation. And one of the kind of 15-20% that I'm looking at is immersive. And we're looking at how to kind of exploit that as a business. But we wanted to learn, and Deepa came along with some amazing ideas and this vision that was kind of inspirational. And we got together and started prototyping. And I think that's the key. I'm sure you'd be the same.
Absolutely.
The key to kind of working in VR is not to kind of set off on this journey at the start. It's to kind of fail around and prototype and unlearn and experiment. Because there's so much about VR and immersive that's really unintuitive. Like, everything that we thought was important wasn't important, and everything that we thought wasn't important was important.
It's so true, because it's a brave new world at the end of the day.
Yeah.
We know user experience, we know user interfaces, and we use them every day. But then suddenly you put that into an immersive space, it's like, okay, how do you know that you can do this, and how do you know that you can journey here? Do you know what I mean? It's a very different thing, isn't it?
Yeah, so it's like the classic, there's a couple of games you can get, obviously, or at least that's how often these toys, or as they look like, start.
Yeah.
And one of the things that I kept seeing again and again was people were saying, how do I crouch?
Right.
Do you know, and you just crouch. I mean, it's just you use your natural body and your natural tools to do that. And but I've also noticed a really interesting thing when we've been doing testing, which is that the really young and the really old totally get it.
Yeah.
And actually, it's this band in the middle that actually finds it a bit tricky. And it's almost like we've institutionalized ourselves to kind of think about, okay, what button do I press? How do I interact with this tool? And I think immersive is kind of almost a tool that's kind of not anti-tool, almost, you know, and it kind of, and it's really unintuitive for people who kind of grew up in this internet age.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I think what's interesting is that, like, the gateway to you, for you, was music with Bjork.
Yeah.
And you're trying to do the same thing with music.
Yeah, absolutely.
How important do you think music is then to hit those senses in a way that allows you to understand this reality in a more organic way?
So I mean, 30% of the brain is all to do with vision.
Mm-hmm.
But what I've found is once you hit that kind of first marker and you get the kind of visuals right, after that, everything else is a multiplier. And audio is really more important than people imagine. And so we work very, very hard with David Baxter on the project to do positional audio so that, like, sounds sounded like they were coming from the right places. And that was like night and day.
That's the truly immersive experience.
Yeah. Yeah.
As you move your head, sound changes. And that really just tunes you into exactly what's going on.
And even commissioning, I mean, I had to set up a new company for this project to happen as well, VR&I Limited. And part of that, in terms of the funding that we got from NI Screen, was to bring on board the sound engineer, David, and he has written specific soundtracks for each portal, and that's so important in terms of the user may not be aware of it, but it will influence that experience enormously in terms of setting the atmosphere and the feel and enhancing it, you know, that much further. So
I feel like hearing is, well, we could argue which one is the most important sense, but it seems like you accept things because you're always, you know, aware of what's around you, and if that feels safe, you're more willing.
I think if you connect those two things, it's incredibly powerful.
And it has to match as well, obviously,
absolutely,
the visuals and the audio.
Yeah.
I mean, that's absolutely critical.
Right.
It's a really important kind of concept that comes out of the back of this called the fidelity contract. And what that means is, you can't change the user's expectations about what the world will do. Now, you can actually do bonkers things, like you can mess with physics, you can turn gravity off, you can do all these things, and people still have great experiences. But if somebody looks at something and it doesn't make the right sound or doesn't move in the right way, that's for that intuition about what the experience
it's jarring,
is, it just breaks.
And
it's like a house of cards, it just comes down, and then that's what people are saying then is bad experiences.
Mm-hmm.
I loved, Deepa, what you were saying, actually, right at the very top of that, that your experience, that you were feeling not very well, and you went into a VR experience and actually made you feel better. Because, to be honest, that's the antithesis of what people think about VR, don't they?
Yeah,
I put
totally.
The headset on and it made me feel a bit sick or whatever.
Yeah.
So that's incredible that you had that experience.
Well, we've been talking about this in terms of medical use of VR, and I mean, Luke actually put it in a really interesting way. It's a way of hacking the brain.
Absolutely.
You know, and it did what the paracetamol couldn't do that day. It's
incredible,
You know, and it stayed with me then. I mean, I was fine for the rest of the trip. So it's really powerful.
Probably helped that it was Bjork's content, right?
Yeah.
Amazing.
Yeah.
So Deepa, you have this idea, and you go to Luke and you talk about it. How much control, because as an artist, I'm sure you'd like to have all the control about what comes out and how you express yourself. Now you have to concede some to work with somebody else to actually visualize or to realize your dream. And then now you got to bring in a sound guy, and then all of a sudden all these layers. Is it what you're seeing now, what you envisioned from the beginning?
Do you know, the most successful projects for me over the last few years have been the collaborative ones, and those it can be quite a solitary existence working as a visual artist, but I've really enjoyed working with good people who are excellent at what they do, and they've got industry-relevant experience. Mm-hmm. And in RETNE, there's one of the portals, you're in a library, and there's a phrase that appears, and it's a quote from Aristotle. And it says that the whole is greater than the sum of all its parts. And if ever a process signifies and represents that, it's this process. Excellent. You know, we had, the technical lead in terms of Luke and his VR experience is second to none. All his developers, the animation team, the audio, we've just had such good people. Mm-hmm. And everybody has brought in their particular slant on this, and it's added to it. I had to be incredibly flexible. I mean, I had over those 30 ideas, and these guys started testing them straight away, and were coming back very quickly in terms of what could work, what was tricky, and what was very tricky. And anything that was tricky or very tricky was out. We were in a really tight deadline. We had South by Southwest in mind, so we were really very, very clear at the start in terms of what's going to make this bad. But conversely, and more importantly, what's going to make this amazing? And that's kind of what we really focused on. So we wanted content that was really going to blow your imagination away, and RETNE does, because it's really surreal. We wanted really good quality rendering and animation, but we also wanted a really strong storyline. And alongside that is a really strong character, Little Mo, who's your guide through the journey. And we were really lucky to get the actor Michael Smiley on board as the voice of Little Mo, and he has brought him to life. It's just his personality and humor just really come through this character. So
it's exciting.
Yeah, it's immensely exciting, you know, and I just can't wait for people to experience it.
So Luke, you're at this coffee shop, you guys meet, you leave the coffee shop, and you're like, will you go back and tell the guys, everybody you work, you can't imagine what I just who I talked to, what happens here, how are we going to build on this? I mean, how excited are you after hearing her ideas?
Yeah, it was really, really exciting. So we were kind of mulling over a couple of different ideas, and Deepa came through with this really great vision, like I mentioned earlier. And we were telling the team, and the team got really, really excited about it, because we hadn't really, VR so new, nobody's really done anything before, or at least this iteration of it, right? It's kind of almost the longest one, the longest technology arcs we've ever had, 50 years ago almost we've been working on this. But it's only been in the last couple of years that the tech has almost just got to the level of, it has literally just reached this bar, and it's so much more sailing to come. And the guys have been working on it, and we've been talking to our customers about it, and the reality is, it fires the same kind of mechanisms in your brain as doing normal things. So we're looking at things like training, and that's really interesting. So taking something really expensive, like fire brigade, police training, and astronaut training. I mean, it's really obvious places to look at. But then we needed to learn, but we still have those things weren't ready yet, and we had this huge learning curve with Deepa. But especially it was less about technical and more about almost like psychology and user experience. And I think that's a huge thing that VR really needs right now is more designers and more people that care about the psychology of how people interact with things that kind of come into this. Crystal Beasley on YouTube is a great place to look for that. She's doing some great work.
And Tim, with the tin.
Yeah.
You guys see VR, it's up and coming.
You guys want
to jump in with both feet. You go the music route. Yeah. Is there any other places you want to explore, or is music...
As I say, the application that we built, which is effectively a website, so you can view it on a traditional computer, but you can put it on your mobile phone, you can stick it into a headset, you hit the goggles button, and then you have this VR experience. And that for us was really important. So we're web developers, in essence.
Right.
We're not VR developers. We don't code Unity. So we don't do this. We don't do the entertainment side of things, and obviously the movie side. So we wanted to build something that would work across the board. Now, as I say, our experience works across all these different platforms, which is fantastic, but you imagine that application, as I say, you're searching through 20 million music artists on Spotify. You can apply that to anything, any sort of big data, any sort of data visualization, anything that you need to explore, a huge data set. The thing that really interests us is that, you can suddenly take this journey through big data, So we want to apply that to our business clients. I'd say very much Band Explorer was a test to see where we can go. Obviously, when you start using HTC Vive and stuff, it takes a whole other dimension. But
yeah, I can kind of imagine the experience that you had. I mean, how do you visualize that, right? And I mean, one of the things they hit, well, 9 degrees of freedom, so that's like ability to kind of properly move around in a space. Mm-hmm. And the HTC Vive is one of the first products that I've certainly seen that meets that grade. But one of the things that you can do, maybe perhaps unintuitively, is like you could turn space into time. I mean, in your use case, for example, if you had that experience, you could have all of these tracks laid out, and as you actually move through a space, the kind of world moves around you as if you're kind of walking through time. Mm. You know, and these are really unintuitive things that you can do with this, and but it doesn't feel unintuitive because it's like using Andy tool, you know, going back to this kind of experience.
So you guys are here at South by Southwest, see some competitors, of course. How do you guys differentiate yourself in this space? Who wants it? I'm gonna set it right here.
I'll start with that. I mean, I think the process in terms of getting RETNE to South by Southwest is unique in terms of all the partners that were involved in realizing this. And you know, it's come from Northern Ireland. We've had Invest NI, Digital Catapult, Kainos, Northern Ireland Screen, VR NI, NTS, David Baxter. I mean, I think that's, and we were able actually to bring on board a trainee as well, which I'm really, really pleased with.
So you're carrying a Northern Ireland flag, right?
I am, absolutely.
Team atmosphere together.
Because we had a really tight deadline. But I think it worked because it's a small space, but we were able to make the connections with the people that we needed to work with to realize this project really quickly. So there was little noise, there was no time wasted in that. And it was a collaborative approach. Everybody wanted this to happen and was doing their best to make it happen. So what we've produced is, it's pretty much, we started the playtesting in November, but the real body of the work in terms of the animation and everything, that's just under 6 weeks worth of stuff. Yeah. And when you see it, it's pretty mind-blowing that we've achieved this in such a short space of time. So that's what I'm kind of putting out there in terms of what we've been able to achieve.
Can I ask, from your visual representation and then handing over to the guys and obviously the creative artists and the coders, what did you present? What did you put up front? Was it digital files or was...
No, it was, we started with pen and paper.
Literally.
The drawings, text,
always the best place to start.
And then treatment, which I had to do in terms of accessing the funding. But that changed, you know, I mean, you were asking this question earlier on in terms of being precious. The treatment, I go on bike rides to think and ideas come. Fantastic idea, this is awesome. Brilliant. And then Luke would come back, this is not going to work.
I'm sorry.
Okay. So another bike ride, but each time it improved, you totally have to be not precious. Because it's about the final thing
this
being
is the thing
as awesome.
That collaborative process.
Yeah,
right?
Absolutely.
Absolutely. We work together with different skill sets.
I guess if you walk in with an idea, knowing that you're going to have to share it and be collaborative, it makes a difference as opposed to this is my baby. I don't know if I want to.
Sure.
You can take a look at it. It's cute. You know, this baby, but I don't know.
But that's
share.
A difference between it maybe getting made and not getting made.
Right. That's true. Mm.
There's probably a lot of projects out there that never get realized because of that. Mm-hmm. And at the end of the day, I've kind of, my journey as an artist has been self-taught. There's an awful lot of things that haven't happened, not through lack of me, not trying. So when you get the opportunity to actually create something like this, and you've got Kainos making such a major investment, you grab that with both arms.
Yeah, of course, of course. Yeah. And then Tim, for you, with regard to how you get into, I guess you're here at South by Southwest for a reason. So the US market in general, or maybe the global market approach to what you're trying to do.
So we've got a number of big US-based clients. Yeah. So we travel over to the States quite a lot for business. My business partner and I, Jamie, came out last year to South by for the first time, and we were blown away. Brutally honest, we were blown away by the amount of stuff that's going on. So this year we decided we wanted to come back and we wanted to share it with a team. So we've got 25 people down in our London studio, we've got 5 up in our Newcastle studio. So we wanted to share the love. So we ran a competition, basically a 3-month competition to get all of our sort of social media superstars to put the best content out there of the things that we're interested in, which is VR, AR, Internet of Things, all the pillars of our business. And we ran a social media dashboard, which monitored stuff, and we scored it against sort of retweets and stuff like that. And basically the winners came with us to South by this year. So there's 6 of us from the tin this year that have come out. And we've got one of our young designers, one of our young developers, do you know what I mean? So I know, as a 40-year-old man, that it blew my mind. So if you're like a 23-year-old developer or a designer, whoa, this stuff is incredible. And literally in just in the 2 days that we've been here, do you know what I mean?
So when you hit the ground here in Austin, are you thinking, I'm going to learn a lot, or I'm going to kind of see what the competition is doing and I'm going to squash them? You know what I mean? Is that an element of, I'm sure maybe it's a balance of both, because for me, when I do create an idea or if I have something, I want to see what other people are doing, but I also don't, because I want my stuff to feel original in some ways. Mm. And maybe that speaks more to what you developed and how you enhanced it.
I think so.
It's a process, right. You know, and things don't sit in boxes. Yeah. And the more you talk about what you're doing and people react to it, the more you learn. I mean, I got here on Friday yesterday. I was able to experience some other VR. And there's some really interesting stuff at one of the hotels, Afro-speculative feminism, which is about gender and race and identity, and that's actually sparked something else in terms of future work and possibly, you know, in terms of how VR, when you're in that world, you will accept the avatar that's represented there. Mm-hmm. It doesn't need to be you, and just in terms of how we perceive each other, in terms of
that can be pretty powerful.
Yeah, absolutely. So it's a holistic process. Yeah. I think.
Right. I think it comes back to the thing we've talked about earlier, the way you guys work together, is the collaborative things. You know what I mean? There's so much cool stuff out there.
Right.
You know, we come to be inspired.
Right.
I mean, there's a lot of clients out there. We've got some great clients as an agency, and we'll meet some more this over this coming 7 days, I'm sure. But just to see the stuff that everybody else is doing, and also share experiences.
It's open innovation.
Do you know what I mean? Totally, man.
Yeah.
Share your ideas, and because like, the world's so big now that almost like it's never unique, you know. And the only way you can get there is together. It sounds a bit cheesy, right?
Yeah, but it's
is there any hats that you guys have to wear now that you never thought you'd have to wear throughout this process? You know, maybe sometimes artists just want to create. Yeah. They want to have to put themselves out there and speak.
Deepa's now a tech guru.
Yeah, right. Or you know, there's maybe a hat that you seem like you're ready to wear any hat.
Oh, right. I love a hat.
About you. But I mean, that's what I also like, when you start with these small ideas and then just grow and grow and grow, and as you add layers, you're like, wow, I'm actually leading a team, I'm doing all this stuff. And do you ever kind of lose sight of what you started with in the first place, I guess? And I really like the creative process and how it kind of humanizes what you guys are doing. So I'm fascinated about that part of it. So I don't know if anybody, maybe you're wearing exactly the hats you're supposed to be wearing.
I guess from my point, my job role requires me to wear, you know, as many hats as I need to wear, but certainly a new one that I had to wear was like almost the bad cop hat. I actually am really quite sensitive with motion sickness, actually, so...
I thought you could say something like sensitive about life. I don't know if that's the show, Luke. I mean, we can talk about it off camera if you want, but yeah.
So like if it's not a performance, and so I had to be the bad cop, I'm not used to playing that card, so.
You were our critical friend.
Yeah.
Yeah, like, gets thrown out the window.
Beautifully put, our critical friend.
But no, that was really important in terms of having that feedback. I mean, just as producer on RETNE and creative lead, there was a lot of admin, form filling and processing, but you know, it's a means to the end.
Right.
And everybody has elements in the work that they do that are less attractive, but you've got to do them, you know?
Right,
it's what being a grown-up is, so.
Yeah.
I don't know if I'm a fan of that part of it.
Coming back to the hats thing, I find the VR thing fascinating, and my team will back me on this, because suddenly there was so much crossover.
Yeah,
traditionally,
for sure.
We have designers, and we have developers, and we have front-end, and we have back-end.
Yeah.
Suddenly, when we're working in this VR space, again, it's a little bit Wild West. This is all new.
Yeah.
The user experiences, the user interfaces are all new. So suddenly there was this fantastic collaboration between our teams.
Yeah.
Literally,
yeah,
they go, okay, so how are we actually, I want this to work like this, but how are we going to visualize that? So we were getting this really, really, really close working relationship between our team, which was great to see again.
Yeah.
Because people do it. You're a designer, you're a developer, da 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 da. Suddenly within this new, this new medium, you do really find that people have to overlap. So many hats.
Yeah, that's really interesting. I mean, in terms of, and I mean, one of the key things that's coming through in terms of the sessions that I've sat in is just how experimental everything is at the minute. So you can't really do anything wrong. The process in terms of how you're doing it is equally important, I think. So, I mean, the message is just learn, and keep doing and building.
Love it. Yeah.
Because you guys turned around your project so quickly in 6 weeks,
incredible.
Was there a part along the way you're like, oh, I wish we had time to do this? And sometimes when you're in the middle of a project, you're like, oh, next time, I'm definitely going to do this. I can already see I've learned so much in these couple weeks. has that, I assume that happened in some capacity where the next iteration of whatever you do, I'm pretty much leading us to the future of VR and where you guys are headed. But sometimes that ideation happens in the middle of the project that you're working on, and so I didn't know if that happened to you guys.
Yeah, one of the playtesting. But no, one of the tricky things about playtesting with VR is because it's quite novel and it's quite new, people are like, wow, this is amazing. Yeah. And you're like, no, that's not the answer that I want. You know, I want you to tell me what this experience is like.
Yeah.
And it was really tricky to kind of cut through that noise in a sense.
Right.
So it's probably getting more people in earlier so we can kind of almost get over that hump and then get better feedback, because the only way that we got picked up velocity and started to make it feel good was when we got over that and we got that feedback and said it doesn't feel quite right, or no. And watching people doing really unintuitive things, like we expect someone to lift something in a certain way, but they actually go
they don't do it,
or and it sounds very simple, but it's really unintuitive design for. There's a lot of work to do.
Yeah.
And then for you, Tim. Are you going music videos? You put the VR on, and now you're now in a video with.
As I say,
the Beastie Boys would be amazing, but you know, mugging the favorite camera band, with them would be
band.
Ridiculous.
They were our lead band when we set the app up. They were our start band, the Beastie Boys.
Love the Beastie Boys. So no, I mean, is that what's the next iteration for what you guys can do?
Absolutely. So as I say, for us, it's I want VR to be accessible to the world. Mm-hmm. Okay, and. Again, coming back to HTC Vive, it's fantastic. Yeah. But we're talking like a big investment to get an HTC Vive kit with a PC powerful enough, you know?
Well, they have a monthly thing now.
Which is fantastic.
Yeah, that's great.
But I really feel that the mobile space is where we want to look, because everybody, let's be honest, is carrying a very, very powerful computer in their pocket.
So. I would kind of both agree and disagree in the sense that in 3 years' time, absolutely, when we have this possibility to move around.
Sure.
But to get there, I think the only tool to get there today is the Vive.
Yeah, yeah.
Because
it's an incredible, incredible piece of kit. Again, this is about democratization. I just want, again, the app that we built, to say it works on your computer, it works on your smartphone, it works on Vive, it works on Oculus. You know, so it's just to me that's just fantastic, because it doesn't matter, because we all know about Google Cardboard, fantastic. It's just like a piece of cardboard.
Yeah, for the cost, it's brilliant.
Do you know what I mean? You put your smartphone in there, and you can have a virtual reality experience. Mm-hmm. Now, don't get me wrong, it's not quite the experience you're going to get with Vive, but you can have that experience, and that for me. So whenever we're going to look at, I guess moving forward, looking at VR projects, we'll always look to do something that literally can be across all of these different platforms. I think this is where we're going to be looking.
Yeah, it's really interesting.
Yeah, no, I mean, I think that's an important point in terms of how you enable access to it, because there are barriers at the minute, but those as technology kind of
slowly but surely
improves,
yes,
it will
be
fun
challenges. Yeah,
yeah,
it will overcome those obstacles.
But in terms of what you were saying about deadlines, creatives need deadlines.
They will probably work with it to your advantage.
Yeah, I think it did, because it kind of focused your attention. I mean, there are other things that we had in terms of the script, which were fantastic, but animation is so time consuming that seconds can take days to animate and get it right. So those were the compromises that we made. But going forward, the scope in this, in terms of the character we've developed to create more content, I would love to create more creative VR content, but it's not cheap as a process, and doing stuff with music would be amazing, because that, when you've got music, you've got light, you've got movement, and it's immersive. It's just amazing.
And just quickly to pick up on that, one of the, I think, interesting things about VR as a tool will be that people like Deepa with her ideas can use VR as a tool to create VR experiences.
Yeah.
And you don't need to learn really expensive tools or go on training, and that's another interesting point like for the future of creatives, I think.
Mm-hmm. And then just future of VR in general. I mean, obviously you guys are going at it in one way, you in particular. And then how you guys are seeing it. Where are we going with all this?
I just think this idea, and again, we keep coming back to music. Hugely passionate about music, but this idea that you can have, and we're not a million miles away, to have that virtual reality experience that you could be front of stage at Glastonbury and watching Radiohead, you know what I mean? And that you could be 5,000 miles away, and you could literally be that, and you can have that experience. That to me blows my mind. That's going to be incredible. And we're not so far away, you know? So again, this comes back to democratization. You know what I mean? You may not have been to the 250,000 lucky people that got a ticket for Glastonbury, but you can have that experience, and you can share that moment with millions and millions of people.
Yeah.
Again, watching something on a screen, you can do it, but it's not quite the same, is it, as having that truly immersive
experience. That is a game changer, for sure.
Absolutely.
And however you guys' perspective. Yeah, I love sports.
Yeah. Yeah, I think there's quite a few technical barriers in the way that will limit it a little bit, but I think we'll definitely get there. I mean, like those things are really powerful, those ideas are really powerful. Personally, mobile doesn't, it makes me actually really sick because I don't get, even you know, when you're a little bit moving, and I think that, but when we get that penetration and we have like a VR that's mobile and you can move it around, I think we're going to see some really interesting things that are going to happen. It's almost like the Palmer Lucky DK one moment. I think it will happen again.
Sure,
and this
yeah.
huge like cost will drop and content will be democratized and will really, I mean, entertainment is still a bit of a, I mean, it's going to be interesting to see what happens there.
Right.
But we're starting to see really key things actually working, like VR for work and VR for business is a really interesting area.
Yeah, VR seems to be disrupting a lot of industries.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
Interesting to see.
I think, I mean, in terms of, because we're at this early stage and it's experimental, but in terms of VR, say, I mean, filmmaking, you know, where you actually control mm-hmm. perhaps the storyline and the outcomes mm-hmm. and engaging in that, I mean, that's pretty powerful mm-hmm. and quite new and hasn't mm-hmm. been
I love
fully
this idea of having a non-linear narrative.
Yeah, yeah.
You know
yeah.
what I mean? So you make your own choices.
Yeah.
You know? This is a very cool thing.
Yeah, it's been done mm-hmm. in sort of gaming media, mm-hmm. you know, but it hasn't
right.
been done in VR yet, and that would be hugely exciting.
Right.
But obviously, you know, the same way it's a huge investment at the same time.
Huge.
And obviously also sports.
Yeah,
sports, you could be
yeah.
at St. James's Park.
Yeah.
You could be
that
there.
That would be amazing.
Supporting Newcastle,
yeah.
man.
Well, I could relive the glory years, you know, thinking I can still do it again. You know?
I could be at Sellers Park, you know what
yeah,
I mean? Crystal Palace, man. Right. Fantastic.
There'd be a lot of different directions I'd like to take that. Well, guys, that is all the time that we have. Thank you so much for coming on the show.
You.
Where can people
Thank
find
you.
More information about RETNE?
Okay, we're at the GB House, so today,
okay.
Where we also have Immersed in NI at the GB House, so that's from 2 to 4 tomorrow.
Okay, that's here in Austin, how about?
In Austin, outside.
Online, so
yeah,
keynotes.com/applied innovation, and you can read about the story and
yeah.
Deepa's journey and more about the keynotes.
And then Lil Mo's your character that's
His,
driving
yeah.
everything.
Yeah.
Where can people, is there anything happening over back in the UK, people can really experience this? And
we will be showing this and taking it out on the road, but to be honest, the focus was on getting it here.
Of course, yeah,
when
of
we
of
get
course.
Back, we'll be looking at the
just,
App
I'm
Store.
I'm just excited. I want to check it out. So
putting
just,
it up on Steam.
Yes.
So we're looking at all of that when we get back.
Got it. Okay. Great. Good luck with that.
And I was just going to say, so yeah, basically Band Explorer VR is available now on our website, www.thetin.net. Band Explorer VR is the featured promo, so anybody can go check it out, on a computer screen, drop it into your smartphone, put on a Google Cardboard, and you can have that experience.
That's great, Absolutely. Good luck with that as well.
Thank you, sir.
Look forward to seeing what you guys do in the future. Hopefully I'll get to experience it
myself. Yeah.
And for you guys at home, we got two things for you. One, our stream tomorrow is gonna be at 7 p.m. We're gonna have the winner and the runner-up for the Tech Off competition that's happening. So one of them's gonna be happy, one of them's gonna be sad, which is a little unfortunate, but that should be fun to play off of each other. And then two, I had the opportunity to talk to the Minister of State for International Trade, Greg Hands, who had a lot of insight about British innovation. Check it out. I'm honored to be with the Member of Parliament for Fulham and Chelsea and the Minister of State for International Trade, Mr. Greg Hands. Mr. Hands, thank you so
yes,
much for your time.
Delighted to be here, thank you.
Okay, so what brings you to South by Southwest?
Well, it's we've got a massive UK presence here this year at South by. It's the biggest non-US presence in the whole of the convention, the whole of the festival. And it's really, really important for me as the Trade Minister to promote UK exports
mm-hmm.
and also to show the UK is a great place for foreign companies to invest, particularly in the tech and creative sectors.
Okay, tell us a little bit more about how important it is to have influence here, UK influence at this event.
Well, I think it's really important to show that the UK is a great place for US tech companies to come.
Mm-hmm.
Increasingly, a large number of them are setting up European headquarters in London and across the UK more generally. And it's a really important place for UK companies, UK startups to start interacting with the larger US tech scene. So for both of those reasons, it's really important for the UK to support interaction between the United Kingdom and Austin, Texas, doing South by.
Now, what kind of competition is there between US tech and British tech, if that exists at all?
Yeah, I suppose there is a little bit in places, but we work generally pretty well together.
Mm-hmm.
The UK is a great environment for US tech companies to set up in, to operate in. It's no coincidence that most of the US tech giants choose the UK as their European headquarters. We work well together. The UK government is there to support them. We value foreign direct investment very much coming into the UK. It's really important for us. So I don't think we need to be rivals. In fact, I think we can work together. And actually, a lot of UK companies get a lot of business out of US tech firms, and I think vice versa.
I appreciate that attitude. Now, tell me which British companies you're excited about. You see a lot of tech companies and how they're pushing innovation. Which ones excite you the most?
Well, I think one company we've got here called Laduma, which is very good in VR. We've got other UK companies here that are doing quite a lot in terms of the innovation that we're showing here. So I wouldn't want to plug too many specific companies, but I would say that we've got quite a variety of here on show.
Okay, so there is two clubs that are in your jurisdiction, Fulham and Chelsea.
That's right.
And you're in the trade game. Now, Chelsea's on top of the Premier League. And Fulham is in the Championship, a division below. They're in seventh, not too far from the promotion
That's
spot, but
very
they could
good.
Use
you're
some
good.
Help. Could you maybe trade? I know it's not possible. Could you maybe get Diego Costa or Eden Hazard to maybe step down to Fulham and really give them that push to get back up to the Premiership?
Well, it's a very, very good idea. Trade is what I do, but it's, I do draw a line when it gets to football or soccer. The one thing I would say is that all I can say, I'd be very glad that Chelsea doesn't change its MP as often as it changes its football manager.
Easy, I like that.
A little bit of more job security for me in my position.
That's awesome. And then for all the years you've given to the UK, when will you finally be Sir Greg Hands? When does that happen?
Well, I don't think that's going to happen anytime
soon.
Oh,
come on.
I seem a bit young to be a Sir, so I'm happy just being plain old Greg Hands for the time being.
There he is. Thank you so much for your time, Mr. Hands.
Thank you.
It was a pleasure.
Let's go.